Good morning. I want to make one announcement before I begin. That is, we've decided there will be no Wednesday night Bible study this week because of the threat of snow. We don't want anybody coming out and hurting themselves or whatever. So there will be no Wednesday night Bible study this week. We will continue the following Wednesday, assuming there is no more snow. The scripture this morning is the incredible story, the true story. The three men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Our scripture this morning, our text, is from the book of Joshua. Joshua 24, verse 15. Joshua says to the people of Israel, "If serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your forefathers served beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." Amen. You know, the buzzword today is choice. Everybody wants choice, the right to choose. People want freedom of choice. The fact is that life is a series of choices. And the choices we make in life reveal who we really are and what really matters to us in our lives. The choices we make as Christians reveal a great deal about us, our relationship, and our commitment to our God. We can choose to follow the world, or we can choose to follow Jesus Christ. We can choose to please Him, or we can choose to please ourselves. According to our scripture lesson this morning, one day in Babylon, before a pagan king, three Jewish men had to make a choice, and their choice says a lot about them. Their choice says a lot about our God, and their choice is an object lesson to us. We see in verse 1 that out in the desert, King Nebuchadnezzar erected a huge golden statue of himself. It was about 90 feet high, 9 feet wide. The golden King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon. And then the king called for a ceremony of dedication. People were called together from all the nations of the earth that were subject to Babylon. In those days when the king said, "Come," you came. The people gathered were the cream of Babylonian society. As many as 300,000 people may have been there. Imagine the sight. All of these Babylonian officials in their official robes and in military uniforms. They were standing before the image of the king. It was an exercise in political correctness. Whatever the king approved of, they approved of. An announcement is made. By order of King Nebuchadnezzar, when you hear the music play, all of you fall down and worship the image. And if you choose not to, we have something to show you. Over there, do you see that? You see that flaming furnace? Whoever does not fall down and worship will be thrown into that furnace, burned alive on the spot. That's called motivation. It's a simple idea, turn or burn. They could see the flames leaping upward and hear the roar and crackling of the fire. It was an effective visual aid. Now, isn't that the way the world operates? When the world wants us to turn from our foolish Christian beliefs, there is always the threat of a fiery furnace, one that we might be thrown into. Ridicule, a bad grade, loss of promotion, loss of a job, loss of prestige, loss of friends, loss of money. There's always the fiery furnace for those who may stand true to their faith. So the people knew what they were expected to do. They knew about the fiery furnace and the penalty, and it worked. People thought, hey, we're no fools. We know what choice to make here. And the music began to play, and the crowd was stretches as far as the eye could see. They all bowed down, down. All that is, except for three skinny Jews, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And there they stood in defiance of Nebuchadnezzar. They would only bow down to one God, and this wasn't him. It would have been easy to go down with the crowd, but all three men were made of finer material. They stood tall. They literally stood for what they believed in. It would have been easy to rationalize. They could make excuses to God, but they knew the God they worshiped was a God who said, have no other gods before me. The world says, bow down, you fools. They said, no, we are not fools. And that's why we will not bow down. Sometimes when we make our choices for a God, the world notices. And our adversary, the devil, notices. And they don't like it. The defiance of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego did not go unnoticed. For being true to their God, they were accused of treason against the king. The word accused here literally means to eat the flesh of. We use a similar term in our society today. When we're really out to get somebody, or somebody's really out to get us, we say we're going to have them for lunch. It's the same idea. The intent was to denounce the Hebrews and discredit them. Why is it that the world gets so upset with Christians who refuse to go along or do something a little different? You know, we're told that we live in an inclusive society. The buzzword of society today is tolerance. Yet where is the tolerance for Jesus Christ? Inclusiveness doesn't include Jesus Christ. Why? Sometimes they say Christianity is exclusive. Well, what about Christianity is exclusive? My Bible says that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. My Bible says that whosoever believes in him shall have eternal life. That's everybody. Whosoever. Christianity sounds very inclusive to me. For Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, the charge is treason. They made Nebuchadnezzar look bad in front of a lot of people. Nebuchadnezzar was furious with rage. His pride was ruined. His will had been crossed. In amazement, Nebuchadnezzar asked, "Is this true?" He could hardly believe it. The furnace was ready. The furnace was hot. He could not believe that anybody was foolish enough to defy him. Isn't that interesting? The world often views conviction and principle as foolishness. Nebuchadnezzar believed that every man had his price. And you know what? That's true. Every human being can be bought. In fact, we have all been bought. 1 Corinthians says that we have all been bought with a price. That price was the blood of Jesus Christ. The Bible tells us that we have all been paid for through the blood of Jesus Christ. That's how much we're worth to God Almighty. And now that we know what we're worth, the precious blood of Jesus Christ himself, how can we sell ourselves cheaply for anything less? When anger didn't work, Nebuchadnezzar tried diplomacy. He was willing to give them a second chance. Once again, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were given the opportunity to compromise. Come on, go along with the crowd. Bend a little. Don't be different. But Nebuchadnezzar made a mistake. He mocked God. He said, "Who is this God who shall deliver you out of my hands? Who is this God who shall deliver you out of my hands?" That changed things. Now the battle was no longer between the king and the young men. It was between the king and the God of heaven. "Who is that God? I don't believe that God exists. There is no God who can deliver you from my fiery furnace." We shall see. Nebuchadnezzar was in for the shock of his life. If I may paraphrase the next few verses, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego said, "We don't have to justify ourselves to you. We don't even need to think about our answer. You can save us all a lot of trouble with your second chance. We don't know if our God will save us from your fiery furnace or let us burn to his glory. But one thing we do know. We will not serve your God. We will not worship your golden image. We would rather burn for God than live for you, King Nebuchadnezzar." Idolatry was forbidden by their God. They had God's word written on their hearts. They knew what their answer was. It was the only answer they could give, and they gave it without hesitation. Jesus Christ has told us, "Do not be afraid of those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul." These men had their conviction. They had their courage. They had made their choice. Nebuchadnezzar had asked the question, "What God?" And they answered him in verse 17, "The God we serve." They didn't know whether God would save them from the fiery furnace or not. Their choice was to obey God. That was more important than preserving their own lives. Under any circumstances, they would obey their God. Under no circumstances would they worship King Nebuchadnezzar. They said, "God is able to deliver us from the fiery furnace if he wants to. But if not..." You know, some people serve God as long as he does what they want him to do. But what happens when what God decides to do doesn't really fit in with our plans. Our faith, our conviction of choice, needs to be strong enough for the what-ifs of life. The question is not, can God do something? The question is, what will he do? He may save us from a difficulty, or he may ask us to face the difficulty with him at our side. The question is, do we have enough faith to remain faithful when we don't know what will happen when we enter a situation? It takes great faith to say, God will deliver. It takes even greater faith to say, I choose to serve him, whether he delivers or not. It seemed that these three men were about to burn for their faith. We can imagine how the crowd must have begun to gather. Everyone wanted a front row seat for the show. They thought, this is going to be good. They had no idea how good it was about to be. The king felt he had no choice. His command had been defied. His authority was in question. The king had been painted into a corner. Now he had to punish them. He had to do what he had threatened to do. The angry king commanded that the furnace be heated seven times hotter than it was. You know, for those of us who are Christians, those of us who choose to live for the Lord, life can be hotter than for the rest of the world. Nebuchadnezzar said, turn up the heat. The devil may want to try our faith. The devil may look at us and say, turn up the heat. But when it gets hot, think of this. Isn't it interesting that the heat, the very act which was intended to make the punishment more threatening, only served to make God's miracle more impressive? The furnace was probably constructed with an opening at the top through which fuel could be fed, and an opening in the lower side from which ashes could be taken. The three men were probably thrown in from the top, and Nebuchadnezzar could look in through the side. Verse 22 tells us that the flames were so hot that the flames killed the soldiers who took Shadrach and Meshach and Abednego and threw them in. Could you imagine what effect this must have had on these three men? They were about to be thrown into the fire. And just prior to being thrown in, they saw other men burned to death, right before their eyes. The burning to death of the soldiers was an object lesson of what was about to happen to them. You know, it's one thing to say, throw me in. It's another thing to watch somebody else burn first. Don't you imagine that Satan whispered, see what happened to them? That's what's going to happen to you. Bow down to the image now before it's too late. This wasn't a dream. This wasn't a joke. This wasn't a simulation in Disney World. They were going in for real. The devil must have been gloating. Now see what you've done, you fool. You've gone overboard on religion, you fanatic, and see what it has gotten you. But also notice something else. As the other men were throwing Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego into the fire killed them, but not Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. The miracle had already begun. Already, they were under the protection
of their God. There are those who believe that if this event really happened at all, these men simply walked in, found a cool spot, and waited it out. I've heard some asinine things from non-believers, but I think this one may take the cake. But look at what the Bible says. You know, if they were just finding a cool spot, try telling that to the men who are now dead from the fire because they just tried to throw them in. Verse 23 says that they fell in. This suggests that they were thrown at the top and fell down into the fire itself. In verse 25, Nebuchadnezzar sees men walking around in the fire. Notice verse 21 says that they were bound. In verse 25, Nebuchadnezzar is surprised to see them walking around loose, which suggests they had been bound hand and foot. They surely hoped that God would save them from this ordeal, but in they went. That's the way it is with us sometimes. We wish God would save us from life's ordeals, but to his glory, in we go. It may be the furnace of criticism. If you're successful, jealous people will criticize you. It may be the furnace of intimidation. You feel put down and threatened. Whatever it is, from time to time, we will be thrown into the fire. Peter says in 1 Peter, "Dear friends, do not be surprised at the painful trial you are suffering, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice that you participate in the sufferings of Christ, so that you may be overjoyed when his glory is revealed." Jesus said, "They persecuted me. They will persecute you." But now comes the good part. The men were thrown in. The furnace was 7 times hotter than normal. The soldiers who threw them in were burned to the crisp. Nebuchadnezzar had gotten his revenge, an object lesson to anyone who dared to defy him. Or so he thought. Can you imagine what must have gone through Nebuchadnezzar's mind? The look that must have been on his face? Nebuchadnezzar looked into the furnace. He expected to see 3 men in agony, in torture, maybe even dead already. But what did he see? He saw perfectly healthy men walking around. But he didn't just see 3 men. He saw 4. There was an extra man. Nebuchadnezzar must have looked in there and said, "Whoa." He checked it out. He called out, "Didn't we throw 3 men into the fire?" And his answer came back, "That's right." Who was the 4th man? We only have the eyewitness testimony of the man who was there. Nebuchadnezzar was there. He saw the 4th man with his own eyes. And what did he say? Nebuchadnezzar said, "Looks like a son of God to me." Jesus was with these men, just as he is with us when we go through the trials of life. They were unharmed. Nebuchadnezzar expected them to be burned to a cinder, writhing in pain. But instead, he saw them walking with Jesus in victory. Look at your bulletin this morning. What does it say right on the cover? Victory in Jesus. That's what this is. Real victory in Jesus. Now notice, when Nebuchadnezzar called to them, they came out. Now that is very interesting. Nebuchadnezzar called them to come out, and they did. But if they could come out when Nebuchadnezzar called them, they could have come out before that. But they didn't. You would think that men in flames would head for the exit if they could, but they didn't do it. You know, it's entirely possible that not only were they preserved in the fire unharmed, but they didn't want to come out because they were in the presence of God. They were in the presence of Jesus Christ. Now think about that. In God's presence, in this very adverse situation, this fiery furnace intended for their torture and death, it became a joy to them because it brought them into contact with God. And they didn't want to leave. How many times does adversity bring us closer to God? Who are the winners in life? Would it be the cool people sitting up there with King Nebuchadnezzar, sitting with the king, sipping their boost, but lost in their sins? Or is it Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego having fellowship with Jesus Christ? You know, down here on earth, people who saw the situation that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego had gotten themselves into must have thought, aren't they fools? But the Lord Jesus Christ said, these are my people. They are in this furnace for me. And I'm going to be in there with them. The king again called for his officials. When they arrived, these pagan Babylonians became witnesses to the power of God. They examined Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. On their bodies, the fire had no power. Not a hair of their heads was singed. They didn't even smell like smoke. These young men had been completely untouched by the fire and the heat. Only the rope that bound them had been burned. Now think about that one. With Jesus, not only were they unharmed, but the fire, the very thing that was intended to destroy them, was the agent that set them free. That's a miracle of Jesus Christ. These three men made a choice. Their choice was to honor their God. In the face of fear, in the face of adversity, it was their choice to obey their God. And God honored their choice by walking with them every step of the way. Why does God allow us sometimes to go through trial and adversity? I would suggest that we can learn a lesson from the silversmith. Malachi 3:3 says, and he shall sit as a refiner and purifier of silver. What a picture of God as a silversmith. What does a silversmith do? A silversmith takes a crucible and puts raw silver ore into it. Then he turns the flame on the crucible. He heats it up. He heats that silver until it turns to liquid. And something interesting happens. The silver goes to the bottom, and all the impurities raise to the top. Then the silversmith takes a skimmer, and he skims off all those impurities. He carefully regulates the fire. His purpose is not to destroy or ruin the silver, but to refine it and purify it. He keeps up the process until there's nothing left but pure silver. How does a silversmith know that his job is completed? The silversmith knows that the job is done when he looks into the silver and he sees the reflection of his own face in the silver. When he sees himself reflected back in the silver, then he knows that his refining process is completed. God knows that we are refined and pure, and what he wants us to be when he looks at us and he sees back the reflection of his face in us. We may go through the fire. We may say, why? When is it going to be over? Just maybe Jesus is getting the impurities out of our life. When he sees the reflection of his face, when he sees Christ's likeness in us, he sees our lives becoming more like the life of Jesus Christ. Then he can lift us out of the fire and use us in ways that we never dreamed possible. Choices. We all make them. Life is a series of choices. Our choices determine who and what we are. We can choose to honor God, or we can choose to honor ourselves. It's our choice. We can choose to join the world and sit in the shade with Nebuchadnezzar and the devil. Or we can choose to be with Almighty God, sometimes in the fire. Though serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourself.